Manuel, good morning, Bell. Hope you're doing well. It's a privilege to be able to share with you today. You are visiting where I work. This is the Preaching Lab at Central Christian College of the Bible. So normally I go to you, and today I'm bringing you to campus. This is where a lot of our preaching classes take place, where we film different lectures for the online program, that sort of thing. But I thought it would be fun to be able to utilize this space to share a message with you. And we're beginning a new sermon series. It seemed appropriate to start something new. We are in a very different time, a very different space, where our lives have been turned upside down. I'm hardly ever here, actually, on campus. And I bet for many of you, going to work is an unusual thing. I bet you're really looking forward to getting together and worshiping together at the church. I know I'm looking forward to when I can get back down there and spend time with you in person. But until then, you know, this is our normal. But normal doesn't seem very normal. And there's probably a lot of things. The world has been turned upside down. The question is, now what? What comes next? And so this sermon series is focusing on the now what of life. We're going to be walking through the book of Acts, starting in chapter 1 and working our way through it. And the book of Acts is really answering the question, now what? What happens after Jesus rose from the dead? What does that mean? How do we follow Jesus after the world turned upside down? So if you'd open your Bibles with me, we're just going to start from the beginning, work in Acts chapter 1, and work our way through. So I've got the scriptures right here on this screen, and I'll read them, but I invite you to read them along as well. In my former book, Theophilus, which that name means lover of God, so it may be a euphemism, or it could actually be a person who is sponsoring Luke, the author of the book of Acts. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John," meaning John the Baptist, "baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" And he said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up at the sky as he was going, and suddenly, two men dressed in white stood beside them. So a couple angels show up. They say, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking at the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven." Will you pray with me? Father God, I pray that you would bless us today. The ability to just take in the message that you have for us and begin to answer the now what in our lives. Lord, speak through this word. Shape us, mold us to be more like you. Help us to follow in your footsteps and understand your specific call on our lives. Be with us now, and may we be changed by your message. In Jesus' name, amen. imagine what that was like? You know, these guys have been hanging on Jesus' every word for 3.5 years. And then he dies, rises again, spends 40 days with them talking about what the kingdom of God means, and then does a disappearing act. I mean, there's no magician that has anything like this. He just whoop goes up into heaven and the clouds cover him. It's gone. And they're standing there. You know their mouth was gaping open. I wonder how many of them were like drooling. So, okay, these are the weird things that I think about when I picture what's going on in the Word. But they were staring up into heaven, and a couple angels show up, and they said, "Fellas, ladies, what are you doing? You're not supposed to be standing here. You've got marching orders. You have things to do. Get to them. Because he's going to come back the same way that he left. But until then, get to work." I mean, that's the Brandonian translation of that portion of Acts chapter 1. But there really are, you know, they're staring off into space, and in the back of their mind is, now what? What comes next? Because Jesus was the one who was giving the marching orders. Jesus is the one who was defining their direction. And it's like, how do we follow Jesus now that the world's turned upside down? Well, the truth is, our world has changed radically. And if your world hasn't changed radically, then you're having a different experience than I am. Because I'm being told I can't go to work. You know, I need to stay home. I'm being told, only so many people can go into the store at a time. We have made the switch to ordering our groceries online, which is a very interesting experience. You order them on Sunday so that we can pick them up Tuesday evening. It's just different. Everything's changed. And those are the small things. You know, there are record numbers of people applying for unemployment. Our economy is shifting in ways that nobody ever thought possible just a month ago. And the way that we interact with our friends and family has shifted. The way our social lives happen has changed. COVID-19 has either directly or indirectly touched every person in our country. Because if you don't know somebody who's sick, you know somebody who's helping take care of people who are sick. And you know people that their jobs have been changed, or they have been furloughed, or they are unemployed. Or maybe you are. I found out the other day that even the Supreme Court has changed the way they're functioning. They are actually hearing cases by phone from home. And those phone calls are being recorded so that there is an actual record of this. Everybody has had a radical change in the way that they do life. I mean, just a short time ago, we would have been horrified if a group of masked people walked into any store. And now it is a daily occurrence. And it's happening over and over again. The world's been turned upside down. But what does this mean for how we live our faith? What does this mean for the realities of trying to be faithful to God in the midst of radically changing time periods? The world we live in is a very different place. And with difference, with change, with uncertainties of our economics and of the health care system and how this is impacting global relationships, fear very quickly develops. I don't know about you, but I imagine the disciples, when they're looking up into heaven, seeing Jesus disappear, along with now what, is a feeling of incredible fear. Where do we go from here? Now what do we do? Great, you're alive, but if you're not here, how does that change what the kingdom of God looks like for us? What do we do now? And for us, we just need to state up front that there is fear in the midst of COVID-19. There's fear when our kids can't go to school. There's fear when colleges can't function as normal. There's fear when we can't buy our groceries. There's fear when everybody has to wear a mask. Fear. And so how do we respond to that in being faithful, following Jesus? How do we respond to essentially having our lives put on hold? Well, I think there's a really good note that the Apostle Paul wrote to his protege, Timothy. He says, "For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline." Now, this is the same Spirit that Jesus is referring to in Acts chapter 1. And it's a Spirit that is not about timidity or fear. It's about power, love, and self-discipline. Check this out. We're going to go back to Acts chapter 1. And Jesus said, he's eating with his disciples. He gives the command, "Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." He's referring here to the gift of the Holy Spirit that Paul is talking about to his protege Timothy. He is saying that this Holy Spirit is not about fear. He does not inspire us to be scared. The Holy Spirit inspires us to live boldly, courageously, and take steps of faith. But Jesus is saying, "I want you to wait on this gift to arrive." And we find that happening in the next chapter, Acts chapter 2. But his initial words are to wait for it. If there is a word in the English language I don't like, this is it. I am naturally an impatient person. I want things done now. I want COVID-19 destroyed now. Who's with me? Can I get an amen? I mean, I don't know about you. I'm over this. And the only reason I like fast food is because I don't know of a faster food. All right? I want it now. I'm impatient. And when I miss my friends and family, when I want to be with them, I don't want to wait. And when there's a promised gift, I certainly don't want to wait. But Jesus is saying, "I want you to wait on this gift that our Heavenly Father is giving you, the Holy Spirit." Sometimes we get this idea, though, when it comes time to make a decision, like, "Wait, I just need to wait on the Lord, and He's just going to tell me everything that I'm supposed to do." Okay. There is some truth to that, but waiting is not the same as doing nothing. And so we need to pause for a minute and make sure we understand that Jesus is not saying, "I want you to get paralyzed in this place of waiting." In fact, this is more of an active waiting that He invites us into. To know that we're taking steps with Jesus in this new season, where everything seems up in the air, the first step is to wait. But it's an active waiting. The disciples did what Jesus asked. They gathered in Jerusalem, and they gathered together to pray. Look at verse 14. It says, they gathered constantly in prayer. And the rest of that verse goes on to say, it's not just the 12 disciples, but it's a bunch of the leading women among the disciples as well. And they gathered together to pray together. They prayed individually, but also corporately. This was part of their daily life. But then from that time of prayer, Peter gets up. He stands up among the believers, a group numbering about 120. They have grown. Jesus selected 12. Those 12 invited a few friends. They became 72. And now that Jesus has died and rose again, the core disciples, we're at 120 believers, okay? And they are committed to one another. It says, Peter gets up and says, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry." What he's saying is they're gathering together. They're praying about what it is that Jesus has for them, what this coming gift is. And Peter and probably the group are not just praying, they're going back into Scripture and allowing Scripture to inform them how they are to live. And he identifies that Judas, the one who turns his back on Jesus and betrays him and dies when he hangs himself out of guilt, that Scripture actually implies that he should be replaced. This comes out of Psalm 69 and then also Psalm 109. And he quotes from those. And after quoting those, he comes to this passage, verse 21 and 22 in Acts. It says, "Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of the resurrection." There's... What Peter is saying is, I see that we need to fulfill this role that Judas was to carry out. And so we're just going to find another one who is with us this whole time that meets these qualifications. This decision is coming out of this corporate prayer time, and it's coming out of their contemplation of what Scripture means for them today. How do we know the answer to now what? Well, we wait. And that waiting, it's an active waiting. This time that we are living in is a time like that. It is a time where our world is kind of slowing down and we're in a pause, but it is a time for us to wait to see what God's going to do with it. But it can be an active waiting. The first thing we do is we pray. We pray personally in our solitude, and we pray as a community of believers. Here's what I'm suggesting. You know that I talk to you regularly about spending time in the Word of God, but spending time in prayer and in your journal. I want to encourage you to keep that practice up. Writing out your prayers to God, writing out what He is putting on your heart. But then, reach out to your brothers and sisters here at the church. Okay, they're at the church. I'm here at the college. But you get what I'm saying. This virtual preaching thing is harder than it looks. And maybe on Facebook, where I know many of you are watching this video, this sermon, you know, share your prayer request with one another. Reach out to one another and share what God is putting on your heart so that you can be praying as a community, even in this virtual world. Be sure, these are the things that I need prayer for. And these are the things our community needs God to intercede. What an active way to wait and wait for how He's going to answer those prayers. But then this is a time of active waiting where we evaluate the circumstances that we're living in light of God's Word. That's what Peter's doing. In Acts chapter 1, Peter and all the disciples, they're praying, and then Peter gets up, and he's been just going over, maybe in his mind, or maybe in writings that he has scribbled out himself, of the Old Testament. And he is saying, look, these are things that we know need to be fulfilled, because it says so here. He's allowing God's Word to inform the way he and the church are going to live forward. What are the dilemmas that you're dealing with right now? What are the struggles you have? Is it fear? We've already established that God has said His Holy Spirit, that if you're a follower of Jesus, you've been baptized into Christ and His Spirit dwells in you. That is not a spirit of fear. That is a spirit of power, of love and self-discipline. And so we need to conquer that fear and just say, Jesus, I need your help getting over this fear. There are tons of scriptures. One of my favorite, Joshua 1:9, be strong and courageous, for I am with you. Over and over again, God calls us not to be afraid. But maybe fear's not the issue. Maybe there's some other angst or sin or struggle that you're dealing with. The Bible is full of wonderful verses and stories and pericopes and entire chapters and books that are addressing whatever that issue is. So the beauty of a concordance, look up that topic. Spend some time in the Word and allow it to start to shape your thoughts about how you can interact with your family, with your circumstances at work or without work, or how God's going to provide in the midst of this struggle. But allow your circumstances to be evaluated in light of what God's saying. Allow His promises to begin to shape your active waiting so that you're prepared for what comes next. The last part of this active waiting is to then make decisions in preparation of God's mission. There's a lot of aspects that right now, individually, we can't necessarily address. You know, most of our churches, they can't gather. There are many ministries, youth ministries, etc. There are things that we can't do. We can be planning. We can start looking forward to the future, how we can move forward. We can develop some things that we can do virtually, like a sermon like this. There are other things. Bell, talking to you right now, okay? You all are in the midst of a preacher search, and know that I am praying for you guys. I am really excited about how your leadership is diligently working towards this, and I look forward to the day I get a phone call that says, hey, we've come to a decision, and we're ready to move forward. But you as a church need to be praying for your leaders in that and, you know, asking God, hey, let's answer this in the midst of this COVID-19 thing. But on top of that, you have some leadership decisions that need to be made in-house. Currently, you have one elder. You have at least one other man who is doing the part of an elder, not wrongly. But he is stepping into that role. And it's because God created him that way, I believe. But it's something that you all can start praying about. And you know who I'm talking about. I don't have to name any names. You know who's serving you well and helping shepherd. John's doing a good job as your elder. But when we look in the Bible, eldership is always plural. And so that's something that we need to begin to allow and form our decisions at First Christian Church in Bell. That doesn't need to wait for the discussion of a preacher. Elders were appointed before preachers. Did you know that?
Yep.
It doesn't mean that they one's over the other or vice versa. It means that they work together. And your elders and deacons already are working together that way. I want to encourage you to be praying for them and be encouraging them to start thinking about that decision that needs to be made, because that is a decision that will help prepare you for God's mission. On top of that, there are many of you in the church that are serving in lots of ways that would probably be outstanding in the role of deacon. I want to encourage you to consider technical difficulty here, you can't see it. It's okay. I want to encourage you to be prayerfully considering, you know, God's role for you in different aspects of the church, because the church that you serve in is a wonderful community there in Bell, and God has many of you there that He wants to set apart for that type of leadership. Start praying about it. And maybe elder, deacon, those aren't your things. But there are areas in the church that once you're able to gather together again, you're going to be able to serve in it. I want to invite you to consider what that's going to look like, how you can encourage each other again when you come back. Make decisions of how you're going to live and how you're going to prepare for God's mission once you're together. Part of this also, though, is looking beyond your church, looking beyond the believers, and start thinking about those in your community who might be struggling right now, might be alone, might not have the opportunity to serve or be served by anybody. Loneliness is a terrible thing. How can you be an encouragement, a witness of Jesus, just love for other people? You don't have to preach, but how can you be present? and where the opportunity presents itself to just share how God loves them. These are just some simple ways that we can be actively waiting. Prayer, God's word, preparation. This is the first and initial part of the answer of now what. As we go through the rest of this study of the book of Acts, we're going to see that following Jesus actually gets exciting when he turns the world upside down. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't think God said, hey, I want to throw a wrench into everything and send COVID-19. However, God will use everything for his purposes, the good, the bad, and the indifferent. And he will ultimately use this strange season of life, if we will allow him to have access of our hearts. He will include us in that process. So as we close here today, why don't you begin to actively wait in prayer, in God's word, in preparation for what he has next. So instead of asking yourself, well, now what? We can turn and ask God, now what? Let's do that. Father God, what do you have in store for us as we move through this season of COVID-19 and change and the world literally turned upside down? Now what do you have in store for us? What opportunities are you making ready for us? What decisions do you want us to make in preparation for your mission? What do you want to speak into our life? Lord God, we ask you to shape us in this season so that we're ready for you in the next. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.